This morning's talk relates to one of the questions that Sajid asks, how can one listen? And Guru Nanak explained this more beautifully than anyone else. His sutras are known as pauris, but they are beautiful. And in one of the sutras, he explains the importance of listening. Tirath nava jatis bhava bin bhane ki nai kari jetis sirati upai bekha bin karma ki mile nai matvit ratan javahar mani je guru ki ik sik sun. When you listen to the message of the master, gura ek dev bujhai sabna jiya ka ek data sumai visul na jai. The only secret is that we must always remember that he is the master of the entire cosmos, and this I may never ever forget even. Gurai Dei Bujhai, this is the secret. Sabna Jiya Ka Ek Data, he is the master of the entire creation, not that of Hindus or Muslims or Sikhs or Christians. He is the master of the entire creation. Sabna Jiya Ka Ek Data is the master of the entire creation. This I may never ever. All these secrets are there deep within the ocean, but it is available only to the one who listens to the master. Nanak had strange ways and means. No one could really understand him. This is the case with all those who have discovered his inner treasures. Whenever anyone begins inward journey, he becomes useless for the society or the outer world, because whatsoever he says is not understood by the ordinary. His message is for only those who are seekers. One day it happened, Nanak left home to go somewhere. No one knew where he had been to. He was searched all around. Wherever people found that Nanak could be, people thought he might have gone to any temple or mosque. This is what we understand. Whenever someone becomes religious, either he goes to the temple or mosque or the church. He was nowhere to be seen. Someone said that he has seen Nanak going towards the cremation ground. It's strange. No one could believe this. No one goes to such a place willingly. Even a dead person may not want to go there. That is why he is carried in the hearse. Then how can a living person go there? But Nanak was strange enough. In the cremation ground, Nanak was sitting in meditation under a tree. Everyone wanted to know what he was doing in such a place, away from home and family. People go to temples, churches and mosques, etc. to meditate and pray. Everyone said things according to their own level of understanding. This is normal. When a person begins inward journey, it becomes difficult for people to understand him. This happens because of misconceptions about the spiritual path. Your family, your priests never want you to treat the spiritual path. Now, everyone has said whatever they have to say. Is cremation ground the place to meditate and pray? Nanak was strange. Now it was the turn of a meditative Nanak. He said, one who comes here never goes from. He never dies. The place that you call your home, people die there. Now introspect which place can be called cremation ground, a place where death is inevitable, where people go on dying, or this place that you call cremation ground where no one dies ever. The inhabitants of this place never die. And ultimately, one day one has to come here riding the shoulders of the others. This does not appeal to me. This is the reason I came here on my own. one thing more. In your world, all that you have will be taken away one day. And here in this place, nothing can be taken from you in any way. This incident is very significant as it indicates a greater truth. Nanak is in harmony with all that is to happen. Death is inevitable. Nanak has no conflict with death. It is welcomed. And also, why to bother about this? It is better to come here on one's own. You are always against all that is inevitable. You always wish this should not happen this way. Nanak has no wish of his own. Even if death be the wish of the beloved, it is accepted to Nanak. That night, somehow everyone convinced Nanak to return home. Nanak returned, but he was not the same. Something has drastically changed in him. It seemed that something has given way and something to something new and sublime. It always happens. Only when someone dies totally, that new is born. This is the process of rebirth. You enter a new life. You have to pass through death. And cremation ground is the way. New birth does not imply a new body. This is the birth-rebirth cycle. A new birth really implies dawn of a new awareness. You are afraid of death. And when fear is, you cannot be connected to God. All prayers, worship and righteousness is the outcome of your fear, not as the outcome of your love for God. Then your religiousness cannot be a celebration. God, your religion, all your worships, etc., are all security arrangements. God seems to be your insurance. All your holy places, pilgrimages are the outcome of your fear and insurance security. It is so because you are trained to go to such places because of your demands, fear, and as a protection. Seldom one goes to express one's gratitude to this place. When we go to shrine, we are going to ask for this and that, and so we go to church, we go to temple, we go to mosque or anything. Fear can never take you to God. Fear cannot unite. Love alone is the force that unites. Fear disintegrates. Love brings closeness. Fear breeds jealousy and hatred. As long as fear remains, love cannot spring forth. You can only decorate your hate and jealousy to look like love. How can you love someone when there is fear? Is this in this state? Even if you decide to surrender, it will definitely be the trick of the mind. People go to holy places, etc., full of desires for salvation or fulfillment of desires. It is believed that by bathing in holy Ganges, all sins are washed. Sins, as you call, does not happen by the body. Body is the instrument. Prompted by your consciousness, your body instrument engages in such acts that you call sin. How can holy river Ganges wash your consciousness? Holy water cannot reach there. It is your body that is dirty or full of dust. This can be washed by taking a bath in the river. Water of the Ganges is good to wash the body. Certainly it cannot sanctify the soul. The methodology for this is different. To sanctify the soul, you have to bring another stream of water into your consciousness. From where can this stream spring forth? This can spring forth only from deep within your being. These sutras of Nanak are the search for the eternal truth or for heavenly stream that can wash the sea. Tirat nava jatis bhava vinubhane ki nai karin. What shall you gain by taking a bath in the holy rivers or going to the holy places? If your ways and means, your life, your living does not appeal to him or is in harmony with the divine will, you have really discovered the eternal holy water. The moment you are in harmony with all that is happening and all that is. This can happen when you understand that he is the only doer and you are an instrument. With this understanding, you will appeal to him. Then there is no need to go to a holy place. Wherever you are, the holy places are there surrounding you. It is deep within you. As such as you are, you consider yourself the doer. In all that you do, worldly or spiritual, this doer sense remains like an undercurrent. I am doing this, I am doing that, this and that. This someone has done this to you. You always hear people saying things like this, that, and this indicates the doer element. As long as this doer element remains, you are not religious. A religious person is one for whom God is the only doer, and he is an instrument. It is because of this doer consciousness you are in constant misery. Are you really the doer? Birth, death and life, nothing is in your hand, and yet still you consider that everything you are doing. This is ignorance. The only ignorance from the very beginning. Nanak says he is the only doer. Your definition of sin and virtue differs from that of Nanak. To consider yourself doer is the only sin. And if you want to use this word, otherwise for me ignorance will do. All that you do with this doer awareness is ignorance. And to remove that ignorance is the way of divinity. This is what Krishna is asking Arjun. Krishna is asking Arjun, leave the awareness of doing. You are not the doer. Everything happens because of this cosmic law, or as Nanak calls it as hukum. Hukum means the cosmic law. The season, the rain, the sun, the water, everything happens because of cosmic law. A law has been there and it is happening according to that. If you have consciousness, if you are really understanding that he is the master of the entire creation and I am simply a small iota in that, then it may become a different. Nanak says, be an instrument. Flute is an instrument. Flute does not impose anything of its own. It has three qualities. That's why almost in all the ways, whether it is Chinese, whether it is Jalaluddin Rumi, whether it is Krishna or anyone else, has emphasized flute. Firstly, flute is hollow inside. It has nothing of its own. Hollow. A seeker has to be like a flute, hollow deep within. No resistance, no desire, absolutely nothing is there in the flute. Secondly, flute does not say anything on its own. It is an instrument. It allows the flutist to bring out that which is deep within him, the eternal music from deep within through the flute. And flute allows it. When the lips are put on the flute, the air is blown, because of the hollowness deep within the flute, the music, a melodious sound emerges. And lastly, whenever flute speaks or says anything, it is always a melody, a song, a rag, a musical composition. And there remains total harmony between the flute and the flutist. In fact, flute expresses the moods of the flutist. Flute expresses the moods of the flutist. A seeker, a disciple is like a flute hollow within. He has no desire of his own, nothing of his own. Nanak says, be like a flute, and one who becomes the instrument is dear to him. Divine love flows incessantly each finite moment. Only your pot is upside down. This is not conditional. Love is showering, your pot is turned over. The only thing that you have to do is turn over your pot facing the mouth upward. It will start collecting the rain of bliss or love. His love is unconditional. This is no condition as you may think. This is the problem with worldly love. Love remains an unwanted condition. The husband, the wife, the father, the friend, everyone has certain preconditions for their love. Wife says, I can give you love only if you can. So on and so forth. Because of this, there is so much love talk in the world. However, love is not seen anywhere. Turn over the pot of your being. Allow your pot to fill with this energy. This is methodology. This is transformation. Drop by drop, pot will fill one day. And then it will start overflowing. It can never contain love within. When cloud is full of rain, it must shower. When the flower is full of beauty and fragrance, it has blossomed, it can no more contain its beauty and fragrance. The whole atmosphere and the air gets filled with its fragrance. So too, as soon as your pot is full, it will start overflowing. There is no end to his blessings or his bounties. Once you know the art of turning the pot upside, nothing else is needed to be done. The rest happens on its own. And a master is one whose pot is not only full, instead, it has now started overflowing in all the directions without any condition or prejudice. Tirat nava jatis bhava bimhane ki naikari. What is the point of taking the bath in the holy river or holy waters or visiting the holy places if your consciousness or your understanding is not in harmony with the divine being? The moment you are in tune with him, you have taken the holy bath, you have visited the holy place, it is not that you do not appeal to him. Not even for a moment he wants this to happen. Existence has loved you. Sun gives you light, moon gives you its cool light. You are created by God. Entire existence supports you. You are running away from him. Your doors and windows are all closed. Open the windows and the doors and light will fill your room. Because of your fear, security, all the doors and windows are closed. According to Nanak, the most important thing is that you appeal to God. And if it is not so, then your even taking a bath in the holy waters is meaningless. To Nanak, all these things are irrelevant. The most important thing is your being in harmony with the divine being. If your life, your understanding is not in harmony with the divine will, then every act will certainly strengthen your ego. Look at the pilgrim. When he returns from pilgrimage, he is even more egoistic. He expects a warm welcome that he has now returned from the pilgrimage. Even your fasting is to strengthen your ego. Try to understand all that happens in this life. All you achieve is through efforts. Love cannot happen by efforts. Love springs forth from an unknown realm. And when energy overwhelms you, change begins to happen. All that is sublime and divine is nature. It is very simple. When you are sailing your boat against the breeze, it will be difficult. And when you start sailing with the wind, it is effortless. To attain to your inwardness, no effort is needed. For this, you need a loving heart. And then things begin to happen on its own accord. Love is energy that springs forth from deep within your being. It is an unseen but realized truth. In the beginning, love is a feeling. And as it happens, it becomes an energy field. Love is the only that never exhausts in the world. Love is divine. Love is not any effort. And the paradox of love is, the more loving you are, more love will enchant your being. The more your capability or intensity of loving increases, the more tranquil you are. Love goes on increasing in infinite quantum. Love is a blessing. Love is not an effort. In love you rest. Love rejuvenates you. Love brings freshness. Love fills your being with ecstasy. The day this love springs forth and gushes to your being, you are transformed. One cannot attain to this through efforts. Only by the grace of the one who has experienced this can happen. If you have to prepare your eyes to look at the sun, then you have to begin with a flame. Only then, slowly and slowly, one day you will be able to look at the sun. If you have to start strengthening your inverted pot, if you have to start straightening your inverted pot, you will have to begin with the master. Master is the beginning. When you start overflowing with the master and all your fears vanish, trust and certitude arises, only then you will find an opening in you. If the Ganges has to be brought down to the earth, a Bhagiratha sage, a Shiva is needed to sustain the force. The flow of energy is so intense that an ordinary heart cannot encompass the flow of the love that gushes through the divine. Your journey has to begin with the master. Master will prepare you. He will nourish and nurture you. And in the process, when you are ready, you can have a direct communion. And one who listens to even a single message of the master, can attain to God. And one who thus listens to a master, his intelligence becomes like a precious gem. Mati vich ratan javahar manik, je ek guru ki sikh suni. Mati vich, there are precious gems and jewels, but these are open only to the one who listens to the message of the master. Sikh means the teaching of the master. even if you understand a single word that will transform you, it is very difficult even to listen to a single teaching of the Master. It is difficult because your whole life has to transform and you are never ready to listen to the Master. One never listens. What we listen to all that conforms with you. You have to be within his energy field. You have to learn the art of being silent in a state of thoughtlessness. And when you are in the company of the Master, you cannot remain in the mind. You have to move to the center of the heart. You will distort the words of the Master. You will give your own meaning to the words. Your mind, which is the aggregate of your conditionings, thoughts, etc., will distort everything. Empty-handed you came, and empty-handed you will return. The teaching of the Master is not heard through the mind. It is to be heard through the heart. And when you are listening to the Master, do not bring your mind. This has to be heard with love and interest. Coming to a Master implies that all your efforts have now proved futile. Now you are incapable of moving on your own. In short, this process is trust. You can reach the Master only when doubt is no more. Without inner preparation, you cannot reach him. And one thing more, the moment a disciple is born in you, Master will appear. There is a beautiful saying, the Master appears the moment disciple is ready. Disciple is the one who has dropped the realm of the mind. Trust has arisen in him. He can now trust the unknown. When unknown speaks to you, or something, an unknown situation comes to you, you never accept it. There are different stages. When you come to the Master, you are a student. A student is full of logic. He argues. And then from a student, you become a disciple. You begin slowly and slowly begin to listen to the message. And then you become a devotee. Trust is born into you. You are devoted. Devotee is not a Hindu word. One in whom the trust has arisen becomes a devotee. Many come to the Master, but rarely comes a disciple, one in whom there is trust. With trust, surrender becomes possible. Love and trust harmonizes the energy of intellect. Only such a person can listen to the words of the Master. Only then you can be a Sikh. Sikh means one who listens to the teaching. One who has listened to the teaching of the Master. And teaching of the Master is a blessing. This word Sikh is beautiful. It comes from the Sanskrit root that meaning disciple. One who is ready to learn is really a Sikh. One who has put the attire of a Sikh with a turban on his head is not what Nanak meant by this word. To be a Sikh is a miracle of the unknown. Nanak says, Mati vich ratan jawahar maani je ik guru ki Sikh sun. One who has listened to one teaching of the Master, a single, a solitary teaching of the Master, many gems, jewels, and precious metals are available to him deep down. There are two ways to listen. One is the way that emanates from the head or intellect. Duality is the way of intellect. Intellect very easily comes to the conclusion. Intellect always thinks in terms of right and wrong, good and bad, high and low. Intellect thinks whether to accept it or not. Intellect is supported by ego. intellect can never trust the heart. Culture of intellect dominates. You pass on the street, seeing a hungry beggar, the heart wants to give something. The intellect and the others in the car will immediately ask you to lock the door. Even if you want to give, intellect will give many arguments. Maybe he is a professional beggar. He looks so strong, why he does not earn? And the children will give you their own arguments. Someone may say, don't give him anything. Otherwise he will recognize the car. And next time, any one of us may be driving the car and anything may happen. This is how the intellect works. Love springs forth. Intellect will argue love is blind. Never trust love. Be wise. Love has destroyed many. Love is like a thoroughfare that always leads to the forest and gets lost in the wilderness. Never trust love. Love is the path of aloneness and intellect is the path that follows crowd. Love needs privacy. Intellect seeks so many obstructions and slowly heart space begins to shrink. The space between intellect widens. And then one day you cannot listen to the whispers of the heart. Even your love emanates from intellect. Have you ever thought of this? Your heart space becomes barren. There is no ripple, no song, no dance. The teaching of master is to be heard from heart. Kabir says one who is ready to cut off his head can really attain to love. All those who have understood the inner secrets speak of this. When Bodhidharma went to China, he said there is no point in facing the wall of men. No one listens. When after 9 years, he remained sitting in meditation facing the wall, and a man came named Guanyin. He said, turn your face towards me, otherwise I will cut off my head. Bodhidharma said, that will not do. Then he says, I am ready to cut off my head. He said, then something can happen. Kabir says, one who is ready to cut off the head can walk with me. Otherwise you cannot walk with me. The teachings of the master is heard from the heart. Kabir says one who is ready to cut off his head can really attain to love. One day I'll take some of the sutras of Kabir that relates to this aspect. Intellect is borrowed. It is given to you by the society. You were born with heart. And this is a sad plight. All that is imposed on you becomes important. Your center has moved from the head, from the heart to head. Nanak says one teaching of the master alone changes the entire perspective of life. What is this single teaching of Nanak? He says, Gura ek dev bujhai. One secret can be the remedy for all ills. Buddha says awareness is the only remedy. And is there any difference when Nanak says Gurai Dei Bujhai? And what is the secret? Sabna Jiya Ka Ek Data Suno Visar Na Jaye. He is the master of the entire creation. He has given birds to a tall, to a short, to a black, to a white, to a bird, to a flower, to everything that we see around. He is the master of the entire creation. This I may never ever forget, even for a single moment. This is the secret. This is the only secret. And Buddha's way of saying is, let there be awareness and nothing else. you are suffering from this jealousy, hatred, lust, greed. Let there be awareness and that will take care of it. Nanak says that if you are jealous of someone, if you have a hatred towards others, if you are have fear for something, just remember he is the master of the entire creation. And that is what the Hindu scripture says, Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam, that consciousness, that energy field permeates through everything sentient and insentient. Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam Yat Kinch Jagatyam Jagat. If I can remember this even for a single moment, not even forget even for a single moment, I can enjoy the fruits of the entire creation. Isha Vasyam Idam Sarvam Yat Kinch Jagatyam Jagat Ten Tek Ten Bhunjitha Magradha Kashyas Vidhan. If I can remember this, that the entire creation is permeated by him, he permeates through the flowers, through the birds, through the rivers. If you have eyes, you can see. What is that that blossoms through a flower? What is that becomes a fragrance in a flower? What is that becomes chirping in the bird? What is that becomes a voice in a man? What is that? It is he who permeates through me. I am speaking simply an instrument like a flute. And this is what, when you look at it, the Mirza Ghalib says, oh, everything comes from an unknown realm. And even the voice that you hear is the voice of that angel who speaks through me. I am not speaking. The voice is mine, the words are mine, the punctuation is mine, but the force behind my voice is that of my beloved. This I may never ever forget even for a single moment. And this is the only secret. This is the only teaching that you can understand. I do not forget him even for a single moment. This alone is enough to transform you. Then jealousy cannot remain. How can your left hand be jealous of the right hand? But you are jealous of your friend, your sister, your neighbor. How can this man have so many things and you cannot have? He is using his consciousness, he is making his efforts. When the entire world is sleeping, he is making his efforts. He works day and night. Those people who are in business, they know they work 24 hours. During the day I work in one place, during the night I work in another place. The process goes on. How does it happen? There is a time difference. You want to communicate with someone in China or India or anywhere else. Time difference of 9 hours, 12 hours and so on and so forth. You send a message when you are waking and the message reaches to the person in China when he is asleep. And when you are asleep, he wakes up and he responds to the message and it comes back to you back again. There is no difference, there is no gap. I send a message now and by tonight I will get back the message from China with all the relevant information that I need. God never sleeps. It is through me the message has gone, and through that person in China the response comes in. It is a continuous process, ever awake. And what is that? Sense an inquiry in me? It is God sends an inquiry. And it is the person who sends me a response. This I may never ever forget even for a moment, and this alone is enough to transform you. There are two words. These are two words, remembrance and forgetfulness. The Hindu words are Smaran and Vismaran. Smaran means remembrance and Vismaran means forgetfulness. Remembrance implies that something continues deep within like an undercurrent. You may be doing something else, but the remembrance remains at the background. Look at the pregnant woman. A change has taken place within her biology. As a result of a growth is taking place. As a result, growth is taking place within her. She engages in household activities like cooking, cleaning, and many things happen. Look at a pregnant woman. A change has taken place within her biology. As a result, a growth is taking place within her. She engages in day-to-day household activities like cooking, cleaning, and many such actions. However, she remains aware of the new growth taking place within her. A new life has begun to sprout in her. All through her daily actions, this remembrance remains in her like an undercurrent. Even while walking, bending to pick up something, she never forgets even for a single moment. This is remembrance. Remembrance is not an effort, it is a spontaneous. If it is an effort, one may forget something while engaged in other works, like sleeping, walking, driving, etc. That which comes through efforts is not remembrance. When this remembrance is part of your life, when each cell of your being is soaked into this, Nanak calls this as ajapa ja, means this zikr khafi. You are not saying this, but the zikr is continuing like an undercurrent. We have zikr khafi and zikr zihar, that which is apparent, visible. Jap, you are making an effort. And that which is ajapa, without any effort, that is happening, zikr khafi. One has to move from zikr zihar to zikr khafi, or japa to ajapa jap. Kabir and Nanak calls this surati yoga, the yoga. Surati means a constant and spontaneous remembrance, like an undercurrent. In the West, Gurdjieff called this self-remembrance. He worked tremendously on this. Surati yoga, a constant and spontaneous remembrance, or self-remembrance. No one has to remind you for this. What happens? You have to remind your children all the time. The master has to remind you again and again that this you have to do. When it becomes a self-remembrance, then nothing is needed. Gurdjieff worked on this self-remembrance. He says, if you go on remembering 24 hours something, and this gets intense in you, then a center is born. Crystallization happens. There is a danger in this method, as Gurdjieff asks you to remember I am. The danger is of ego. Such is not the case with Nanak. Nanak never asks you remember yourself. Instead, he asks you to remember Sabna Jiya Ka Ek Data Sumai Bisar Na Jai. He is the master of the entire creation. He permeates through everything. He is the only doer, and this I may never ever forget, even for a moment. He alone is the life giver and sustainer for the entire creation. Nanak asks never to forget this, and this is the only secret. This Ek Omkar Satnam, that truth alone, and that is truth, lurks behind the entire creation, in the cloudy sky, the stars, the moon, the sun, the speck of dust. This Ek Omkar Satnam, this truth, is hidden. This I may never ever forget. And as this crystallizes in you, something starts transforming in you. Nanak says there is no need to leave the world. The entire world is permeated by the same energy. Wherever you go, you will find him. You will find a vast congregation of followers, Sikhs and others. They are all involved in the world because nothing is outside the creation. But they have forgotten the other half of the truth. The entire thinking and the way of life is worldly. One has to remain in the middle, but intellect always chooses the extreme path. Buddha gave the path of the middle path. Sikhs are all around, however, nowhere the Sikh that Nanak spoke of is seen anywhere. And when this remembrance that he alone is the sustainer remains, then you can be in the world, but the world will not be within you. You can make even Ganges an ordinary river, or you can make an ordinary river as a holy one. You can make an ordinary act as divine act. And that is where, with awareness, with understanding that he is the master of the entire creation and everything, in and through everything, it is his energy permeates. Then cooking, walking, eating, singing, dancing, everything becomes meditative. An ecstatic Jalaluddin makes whirling a meditation. Someone makes cooking as a meditation. Someone else makes painting as a meditation. For Michelangelo, sculpture became his way of worship, way of connecting through him. He alone is the sustainer, remains, then you can be in the world, but the world will not be with you. It all depends on your level of understanding. Nanak says, one who listens to one message of the master, his intellect gets precious like gems. One message that he is the master of the entire creation. Why is Nanak talking of these precious gems? Nanak is using this word for the reason when need arises, you may leave everything but not the precious gem. This remembrance is like a precious gem. This is one of the most important teaching, that he is the master of the entire creation, and this I may never ever forget, even for a single moment. This I may never ever forget for a single moment. And that is the only teaching. Once this has become part of you, you can be wherever you are. You will be blissful and nothing else. Gurai Dei Bujhai Sabna jiya ka ek data, so main bisur na chahta.